Okay, tonight we are on safari, scouring swamp and savannah alike for species starting with S. And look what we've found already, a snake in the grass, Josh Widdicombe. The seal of approval, Callie Beaton. The squid pro quo, Jamali Maddix. And he doesn't give a shih tzu, Alan Davis. Let's hear their calls of the wild. Josh goes. Callie goes. Jamali goes.
Wow.
Alan goes. Oh, it's supposed to be a snail. Second deadliest hunter.
Good one.
Yes. Honestly, sounds like you've got terrible asthma, which of course you do have.
Which I do have. what was the question?
what's the world's second deadliest hunter? I can tell you what the first is, if that's helpful to you.
Yeah, what is the first, then?
OK, so we did it on the O series. The highest kill rate in nature, it has a 95% success rate.
Is it an ostrich?
No. An ostrich?
Callie,
otter. It's otter.
Notoriously dangerous
is
ostrich.
Is it an okapi? No.
No, weird, it doesn't even...
Octopus.
Even
hippo?
No.
Is it a mosquito?
It's a dragonfly.
Oh, jeez.
It's a dragonfly.
And yet I went through all animals. Yeah.
It was good, though, to get a list going there. I like that. Hippo is very dangerous, darling. Very dangerous.
Thank you for telling me that, like, so I don't feel silly.
Yeah.
It's a good answer, but it's not the right one.
The weird thing about hippos is that they are tremendous killers, but they're vegetarian.
Yeah. Like me.
Now, that is really hiding in plain sight. I'm a killer. I'm a killer. Vegetarian. Vegetarian, did you know?
I wouldn't be surprised if you turned into a serial killer, darling. You look so weak from being a vegetarian.
No, it's the asthma that's made
me weak. Oh, is that what it is?
They're going in hard on your health.
It'll be awful, won't it, if I don't make it to broadcast.
Yeah.
Right, any more. Dragonfly, that's the first
hunter's
one.
Hunter's bird of prey.
It's the dwarf seahorse.
Of course,
a dwarf seahorse.
I know. They're about 2 inches large. Kill 90% of the time that they try to catch some prey. Most fish of a similar size, they have about a 30 to 40% success rate. And there doesn't seem to be a marine predator with a better success rate. They hunt something called copepods. So they're tiny little crustaceans, which are usually excellent at escaping because they can swim more than 500 body lengths per second, right? That's the equivalent of me swimming at 2,700 kilometres per hour, as opposed to what I actually do, which is look like the Queen Mary coming slowly into port. And they also have some of the fastest reactions in nature. So dwarf seahorses, some of the slowest swimmers in the world. Top speed, about 5 foot an hour.
Is that up or down? Because in the aquarium, they're in the tube, aren't they?
Yeah, but they can do anything. Up, down, sideways, whatever. They're amazing.
They're just going to have Sandy doing that on a GIF.
Yeah. Key to their hunting success is their sort of horsey heads. And what it does, it allows them to sneak up on their prey. So copepods know that there's a predator because they sense the disturbance in the water. But the seahorse's head perfectly is formed to create no wake immediately above and in front of the nose. And they sort of sidle up. They're like ninjas. They sidle up to the copepod and it doesn't even notice. They can be like a millimetre away. And then the head snaps up and at the same time they suck inwards and they swallow the creature. We can show you a video of this. Ooh. It looks so casual. It's just casually going along and there's a copepod.
Gone. What?
Yeah.
So you're saying that little thing can't see it? Because I think I would see a seahorse coming.
Yeah. It's coming up from behind. I think you might...
Yeah, even from behind, I'd be like, is that a seahorse?
Seahorse,
that's
yeah.
What I'm saying.
Seems unfair. Seems like someone should be behind with some coconuts going... Shut up! I'm hunting the time to chase this bug.
They have terrific eyesight, which also helps them. I'd like this. Their eyes move independently.
Of each other?
Of each other, ooh. Yeah. So one can look forwards and one can look backwards.
It's like my great-auntie Joan.
She was one of the great hunters as well, wasn't she?
Oh, stories in our family.
An adult seahorse needs about 30 to 50 meals a day.
Is it they're eating the little things? Is
yes,
that why
it's too small, darling, frankly, isn't it? You know.
So why don't they eat something bigger?
I don't know what's wrong with them.
Because I think to be like the second most deadliest thing, it should expand a bit.
Yeah.
Because when you said the second most deadliest thing, I'm a little bit disappointed.
Are you?
I agree. Because what they've done is they've chosen to keep their stats up.
Yeah.
They're like a boxer that won't fight the big boxers, aren't they?
Exactly. Yeah.
No, they are just going for the little guy, I'm afraid.
Yeah, that's it.
But they are extraordinary swimmers. The trouble is that it takes a lot of effort. They have to beat that dorsal fin 30 to 70 times per second in order to propel themselves along. And if they're in a stormy sea or whatever, they can easily die of exhaustion.
The males have the babies, don't they?
They do. They're unique in that. Males are the ones that give birth. But what I like about them, Callie, they are sickeningly romantic.
Are they?
Oh, once they've chosen a mate for the breeding season, they come together each morning and they perform the courtship dance, which apparently strengthens their bond, and then they travel around, look, with their tails entwined.
Oh, little notes of poetry.
Yes. And then they change colour as they go. They can mimic their surroundings by changing their colour, but they also do it as part of the courtship dance. I think it's lovely. And then, as you said, the male gives birth to the young, up to 2,000 of them, and then the offspring... Look at the offspring.
Oh, you'd think they'd eat one of those in a heartbeat.
But they're left to fend for themselves. And then within a few hours, they're ready to mate again.
And then they just... No, you have their visit.
There's no childcare.
It'd be great if humans did that, wouldn't it? You'd be like, there you go. No homeschooling of the seahorses. You said they're very romantic just for the mating season, though. Because anyone could be romantic for the mating season, couldn't they? It's like when you've got to do years of mating season.
One might be gripping incredibly hard against the other one's will.
Saying you're
like
not going away.
Situation.
That looks quite passive-aggressive, those two. They've had an argument.
The sea's slowest swimmer is also its deadliest predator. What's all legs and no trousers or anything else very much?
Oh. It sounds like my daughter on Instagram, my teenage daughter.
It's a lot of legs and no trousers.
Yeah, they do a lot of that, don't
posing.
They?
Posing.
Yeah. Mm.
Jamali's nodding. Like,
No, I'm not. Yeah, no, I've heard.
Have you?
No, that might
be. I've heard that there are women posing like that on Instagram.
Really?
I've never investigated. I don't even have Instagram. Whatever, be quiet. No.
Sea spider.
Sea spider.
Sea spider. They are almost all leg. Look at these.
Ooh.
They are sometimes known as nobodies. I mean, they do actually have bodies and they have a brain and a mouth and so on. They suck their prey through a proboscis. But the guts are in the legs, the genitals are in the legs, they breathe through their legs, and the males, this is again unusual, look after fertilised eggs by strapping them to their legs. There they are, like that. The main problem is that they have such long legs, and I sympathise with this.
Yeah.
I do.
Yeah.
I've had this happen to me at the seaside. Sometimes barnacles and algae attach themselves. And that slows you right down.
I've got short legs.
Yeah.
How I genuinely have never, as an adult, had a pair of trousers that I haven't had to take up.
Yeah, but what you can do is cut that off and make a jacket. let's have a quick look at the way they walk. The interesting thing is, as they're walking, their way of breathing, they're absorbing oxygen from seawater, which is sucked in through holes in the legs. It is actually quite inefficient, but in, for example, high oxygen freezing waters of the Antarctic, it works well enough.
There doesn't seem to be much going for them, because you said even their way of getting the water in is not very effective.
Yeah. The animals you show me, they're both a bit crap, isn't it?
You wouldn't want to be one of those.
No, I wouldn't want to be them or even look at them, really. I prefer a staff or something. That's just...
my favourite double S underwater animal, sea slugs, also known as nudibranchs.
Is that them?
Yes, I think they're rather marvellous. There's over 3,000 different species, and they have wonderful names like sea clown, shaggy mouse, the wet lemon, the white-spotted sea goddess, the hunchback Doris. The one on the right there is called the blue angel, and the next one along is the yellow nudibranch. Then you get Costacella, the green one, and finally the clown nudibranch. I think they're rather beautiful, don't you?
And they're the same thing.
There's over 3,000 different species. They're the same type of animal.
Can they breed with each other? Can, like, the blue angel mess with the...
No, you mean like taking a Cocker Spaniel and a poodle and making a dog?
Yeah.
No, I don't think that would work out at all. What the blue angel can do, the one on the right, it can eat the stinging cells from Portuguese men of war and store the venom for its own use, and just touching one could result in a sting from it.
That's recycling, isn't it?
check out this next one, the green sea slug. It is one of the only animals to get its food from photosynthesis, so exactly like plants.
Oh, wow.
And it does it by consuming algae and then stealing its chloroplasts, that's the cell parts that are responsible for photosynthesis, and making them work for it instead. So, honestly, it can eat simply by lying out in the sun.
Are you sure it's not just a leaf? It looks like a leaf to me, and you're telling, you're just explaining the leaf.
This is the initiation on QI.
Things are rarely as they seem.
No.
How big's that then?
An inch or two.
Inch or two.
Yeah. So
Alan was like 2 inches.
Yeah.
We're like, no.
Describe a new way snakes are found to get about. Yes, my darling.
Is it one of those motorised scooters?
I think they're...
That shouldn't be allowed on the pavement, if you ask me, Sandy.
Yes, that's at the age I've reached. I go, look at that, and if he hit me, he's not insured.
Too right.
Yes.
They are snakes, the people on them. Yes. I tell you that for free.
They have no lights.
No light?
No lights, no manners.
Have you ever been on one?
No, is it...
No, I would love to go on one.
I ride them all the time. I ride them through the shopping centre with a gang of other kids. They'll start stealing through. Oh, we have a great time.
That's why I want to be friends with you. You make me look more modern. Yeah.
Wow. Cheers, mate.
They go, snakes go quickly if you pee on them.
I mean, you'd have to be confident, wouldn't you?
I'd say same with humans.
Yeah.
So I was in Yosemite and I went quietly off a road to do a pee and I went down the slope and then I peed on a snake and it came hairing out. Do they hair? And then I ran up the slope and I was naked from here to my knees because I hadn't pulled everything back up and there was a coachload of Japanese tourists. But, yeah, it didn't like being peed on. Because it almost looked like it went in a straight line. You know they normally do that.
Ah, well, they move in lots of different ways.
Well, it seemed like it went off like a...
It can do.
Rocket.
It's called a rectilinear movement.
It's been ages since I had an erectolinear movement in Yosemite.
So there was an issue on the island of Guam with snakes, particularly the brown snake. And in 2016, the conservationists were having a look to see how they could prevent them getting to birds' nesting boxes. So they placed a camera next to a nest of mice at the top of an 8-inch-wide metal pole in an enclosure that held 58 snakes, OK? And when they viewed the footage, and this nobody knew this was a possibility, they saw a snake wind its tail around the pole and hold on to the other end of the body to form a loop and then inch its way up the pole. And it is called a lasso locomotion. Let's take a look. I have to say there are lots of different techniques for it.
It's like string fellows, isn't it?
It takes you back.
Speak for yourself, Sandy.
Well, we needed the work. But look at that.
You must like these, Jamal. Are these good?
Jamal, what are these?
I'm just curious. I was just curious. I don't know if is that like a new evolution or is that something they've done forever and we've just noticed now?
It's probably the fact that they've been doing it for a very long time. It's that we've only recently observed it. They now think this is the fifth way of moving. So typically there's the slithering, then there's what's called sidewinding, then there's concertina, and then the rectilinear, and then this one now, the new lasso locomotion.
You get flying snakes, don't you? The reason I know this is because my son's a zookeeper, and I know about animals.
I've got a bit of news for you, Callie. Your son is taking the piss out of you.
Look out, Mum! Look out! It's a flying snake!
Yeah, they jump and glide through the air. That's correct. Yeah.
They just fall out of trees.
Yeah, well, maybe.
What animals is he? Is he a particular animal that he's interested in?
He's doing research on the slow loris.
Okay, which is.
Not quick.
I'm glad you've been paying attention.
It's the only venomous primate.
There it is, the slow loris.
Aww.
Oh, it looks so cute, doesn't it?
Sizing you up to kill you.
Just like a dwarf seahorse.
Like Josh.
It is like you without your glasses on, isn't it? That's so sweet.
Yeah, well, I'd say the glasses isn't the only difference, but yeah.
That is cute, isn't it?
Yeah, it's all right.
You're a tough crowd for animals.
No, I love animals. I like snakes a lot. I remember when I grew up, there was always a guy on the estate who had snakes, and your mum never wanted you to hang out with him.
Are you sure there were snakes?
Because he was like a weird guy.
Well, the brown tree snake is a serious problem in Guam. They probably arrived on cargo or military ships during World War II, and it has decimated the bird population. It's wiped out 10 native species, and that in turn decimated the island's trees because they relied on the birds to spread the seeds, and new tree growth fell by 90% as the birds died out.
Why don't they bring, like, a mongoose and just let off a bunch of mongoose and then deal with the brown snakes?
Then you'll have a mongoose problem. What
and then you bring something for the mongoose. Yes. You know what I'm saying? It's just a chain of events.
Then you bring the seahorse in and it takes out the mongoose.
What they do now, when they've got a pole with a nesting box on it, they put a cone. They put the narrowest point of the cone facing down like that.
Saying no
snakes. Yes. But if there's a wider part of the cone like that, the snake has to let go. Makes it fall off the pole. The good news is they're not especially good at lasso locomotion. It often takes them a couple of hours to just cover 10 feet, and they're a bit slow and they slip back down again.
Idiots.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, I've got another type of movement. This you're going to love. The Chihuahuan hook-nosed snake farts defensively when it is threatened. It's technically called cloacal popping. OK. So they expel air from their cloaca. They have one hole for reproduction, for digestion, so it's all just one hole at the bottom. And it makes an audible noise, and sometimes they do it so aggressively, this farting, that it lifts them into the air.
Oh, wow!
I've dated people like that. It's awful.
That's talent, isn't it?
Isn't that a skill? To be able to lift yourself up with your fart.
See? These are the animals I wanted to see.
OK.
Is it true that, talking of a snake's genitals, is it true that a male snake has two penises, or peni? I just thought I'd throw that out
Which would you prefer, two heads or two penises?
Two penises.
OK.
What about you, Jamali?
Two penises.
But not next to
one another. Not next to one another.
I'd have one in the regular place and one on one hand, on my left hand.
Instead of a finger?
Instead of a finger. I'd always wear a glove.
Yeah.
Why does he wear a glove? He's got a cock hand. I think I'd have four other fingers. I don't think I'd just have the cock.
No, no.
Just pull the glove off.
Yeah. You wouldn't want to look weird, would you?
No. I think it would always be like that, or would it sometimes be like that?
It does be like that.
Yeah. OK.
Awkward, though, wouldn't it? When you couldn't stop your finger. Like an umpire.
I'm sorry I brought it up, Sam. Yeah.
Whereas a second head, what is the point of that?
Well, you wouldn't be lonely.
You could talk amongst yourself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Would we have different personalities?
Oh, imagine. Could be like one leave, one remain.
Yeah.
Oh, then you'd have an anti-vaxxer on you. Oh, they're trying to trace your every move. It's all a hoax.
If you had two penises, if you did, it would be a pair of hemipenies.
Is there anyone that has more than two?
Philip Schofield.
Right, moving on. What's the damn problem with salmon?
Is it that ageing rockers have to farm them, don't they? So, like Roger Daltrey and The Edge, Jethro Tull does it.
Are they now salmon farmers?
Well, they're fish farmers, yeah.
Really? So here's the thing about Atlantic salmon. They swim 6,000 miles to return to the waters where they were born in order that they can then spawn the next generation. And quite often dams block the path, and they have found a solution. It's called the salmon cannon, and it looks like so much fun. You'd want to be a salmon. Have a look at this. But look, there they are shooting through.
No.
Isn't that fantastic?
Yeah, it's fun.
And then out. Boom. I mean...
Wow, it's like when you get the bowling ball back, isn't it?
Yeah, I love that. Fish-friendly pneumatic tubes, and they use changes in air pressure to move the fish along. There used to be, before they had the salmon cannon, there used to be fish ladders. Anybody ever seen a fish ladder? So the idea is that the pools are on different levels so that the salmon can jump from one to another, and it's a bit like climbing a watery set of steps. I mean, the effectiveness of these ladders is questionable, although I have seen the salmon jumping, and it is a marvellous thing. But some species, like the American shad, only about 3% make it actually across, so they're not all that successful.
So that looks like it took a lot of time to make that fish ladder, and then it just doesn't work.
Yeah, it's a shame.
It's a little bit like, you know...
Yeah, but I love the idea of it. That salmon are amazing. They can trace their way hundreds of miles back upriver in order to find out where it was that they first spawned. Something else that travels a long way for sex is an eel. Does anybody know how eels have sex?
Is it one of those things where they do something and then smear something on something and then put it somewhere?
Wow. I mean...
Do you write Mills and Boone?
The answer is We have no idea. We have absolutely no idea. It is one of the great mysteries of the world. They are incredibly secretive. And the mystery of it is what happens in the Sargasso Sea, which is a body of water in the Atlantic. It's believed that this is where both the European and the American eels breed, because it's the only place you find young larvae of both species. But nobody has ever found an eel egg there, or any adult eels, and no one has ever witnessed eel mating. It is just a mystery. And the other mystery is how the American and the European larvae all mixed in together know which one should go off to America and which one should go off to Europe. We just don't know how they find their way thousands of kilometres back many decades later in order to spawn in this one place. Sigmund Freud was fascinated by this. He once dissected 400 male eels looking for testicles, and we now know that they only grow gonads when they need to procreate. So it's in the last year
after
of life.
After a couple of hundred.
What I... What,
Sigmund. Yeah, there's another box enough. Of eels, but really...
on his deathbed in 1874, the German biologist Max Schultz said, all the important questions have been settled, except the eel problem. Anyway, what would you use a thunderstone for? You should have one beside you. This is a thunderstone. What do you think it is?
It looks a bit fossily, my one.
Yeah. It is fossily.
It looks like a sourdough bread.
It does look a bit like a sourdough bread.
Don't eat.
Well, that shows how middle class I've become. It looks like sourdough bread. What happened to me?
Yeah. Did you see Jamali on QI going on about that?
Bro, I could never go back to where I came from. Really.
Even the man who keeps snakes near you doesn't want to talk to you.
Don't go around his house. He's weird. That's the snake guy.
Fossilised sea urchins, they were thought by Scandinavians to have been forged from thunder and found when lightning had struck. And as people believed that lightning would never strike in the same place twice, you would keep one in your house to protect yourself. But it is, in fact, a fossilised sea urchin.
Cool.
And also, because it's Scandinavia, keep the trolls away, stop your horses getting nightmares, look after your milk, you put one on the shelf in the dairy to keep the milk fresh and so on.
Was the horse nightmare, was that a big thing?
The horse is so important to you, I suppose you just don't want anything to happen to it, do you not think?
It's a shame that the horse can't hunt in total silence.
Like a seahorse.
Like a seahorse.
Yeah.
Imagine they've got a cat. I mean, if they ate cats, and only cats, and no-one could stop them.
Well, they can all dream, Alan.
You can't hear them.
The word in Norwegian for a sea urchin...
That was a cat. Well, there's a horse here. It can't be the horse.
The word for sea urchin in Norwegian is krokeballar. It literally translates as crow's balls. Our word comes from the fact that urchin used to be a medieval word for a hedgehog. That's why we call them sea urchins. World's longest living animals, as far as we know. Some of them live to be up to 200. Here's an interesting thing. They use their spines to walk, as well as to scare off potential predators. And between the spines, they have stalks topped, this is quite frightening, with jaws that bite.
Oh, my.
Okay. They're called pedicellariae, and they used to be thought as parasites because it looks as though they're entirely independent of the sea urchin. And there's one that can send a sort of defensive cloud out of hundreds of these. They're like tiny little jaws going like this, OK? And they have muscles and receptors that respond to stimulus, and they continue to bite and release venom even when they're no longer attached to the sea urchin's body. Don't you think that's terrifying?
Like an old man's dentures by the bed.
Exactly,
going.
Just coming after you. It's like something out of a movie, isn't it? Being able to send jaws out to bite.
Yeah. Would you like second cock? Or venomous fingers.
We've all heard about being as drunk as a skunk. But what happens when you're as drunk as a sheep?
Once when I was out running on a Cornish cliff top, there was a sheep and it had capsized and it was on its back and...
They can't get up.
No, they can't get up.
Did you get it up?
It just went through its pockets.
It's to do with old descriptions of people being drunk. So there was a satirist called Thomas Nash, and in 1592 he published a pamphlet called Pierce Penniless, and it had 8 different kinds of drunkard. So here they are. Sheep drunk. What do you reckon?
So sheep, they're quite kind of...
Following other people
maybe?
Around?
Yeah.
A group of drunk?
Quiet.
Yeah, it's incoherent. It's when you simply can't remember what word it is you want to use. Yeah. Swine drunk?
That's a nasty drunk.
Yeah, you become belligerent.
You're lazy, sort of heavy, lumpish. Ape drunk?
Climbing a tree. Won't come down.
You know this one's people who leap about and sing and dance. And...
Oh.
There's always a drunk that you can't get out of the tree.
Come down. Lion drunk?
You get brave. Like...
Aggressive.
Bold, aggressive.
Aggressive, yeah.
Oh, don't. That's the worst, I think.
Fox drunk?
Sly.
Sneaky. Yeah.
Exactly right, crafty.
Untrustworthy. Yeah.
Crafty.
Goes and eats chickens.
Yeah. Martin drunk is somebody who keeps on drinking.
Is this named after a particular Martin?
Yeah, he came up with seven animals and he had a mate called Martin.
Shut up.
Let's be honest, he didn't care about the animal bit. The whole thing was so that he could do the Martin.
Yeah.
We'll show you,
won't
Martin.
Won't buy around. Martin drunk.
Yeah. In 170 years, they'll be on TV taking the piss out of you, Martin.
What about goat drunk?
No. Eat anything. Some people will eat anything when they're drunk, and one of those is a goat.
Goat. It's lechery.
Is it? Goats are lecherous.
Yeah, apparently so. And what about maudlin drunk?
Maudlin.
Just maudlin. Yeah, absolutely.
I've hit about four of those at different stages of the evening.
Depends.
So I'm ape early doors, I think. But by the end, I'm maudlin. But I'd like to be clear, I'm never goat.
Good. OK. The English language has at least 3,000 words for being drunk. They include ram squaddled, tight as a tick, been too free with Sir Richard.
Oh.
Yeah. We don't really know what that is. It might be alliterative. It might be Richard Rum, for example. Or possibly it could be a phrase coined by the great Benjamin Franklin, a tribute to the Spectator publisher Sir Richard Steele, who famously liked to drink. Benjamin Franklin kept a dictionary of words for drunk. He had over 200 of them. He published it in the Pennsylvania Gazette in 1737. As dizzy as a goose, drunk as a wheelbarrow, I quite like.
Oh, yeah.
Been to France. Been at war with his brains, seen a flock of moons.
I like that one.
What is anybody got a favourite word for being one over the one of the eight? There's another one.
Twatted.
Charged.
Charged. Oh, that's quite sweet though.
Yeah, charged. That's
charged.
Yeah, it's Jamaican. Charged.
Is it?
Charged.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. Well, I'm just trying to think what I say.
Wankered.
Squiffy. I've got that's no old time for squiffy.
Yeah.
I think that might be a West Country thing, a bit squiffy on snake bite. Do you think we got squiffy?
Yeah, maybe.
Oh, snake bite, that's a good joke.
Oh,
what is that?
Basically, it's part cider, part beer and blackcurrant juice, but it sends you mad.
Does it?
And they won't sell it to you, so when I go, I ask for it, and they go, well, we can't mix it, so I ask for it separately.
And then you mix it yourself?
Yeah, but then the person behind the bar goes, I know what you're doing with that.
Which of your friends is ordering the straight black currant?
Right, moving on. Which silent saboteur scuppered the Spanish Armada? It's an animal beginning with S.
Sheep, sausage dogs...
slow loris.
Slow loris. Snake.
Salamander.
Snail.
Ships. Nail. Something to do with ships.
Ship-ticks.
Ship-ticks.
Ship-ticks. What? Like a tick, but on a ship. Ship-tick.
Oh, I like that. Kind of.
Yeah.
Kind of.
Kind of, in a funny sort of way. It's shipworm.
That's not a thing.
I'm not going to lie, I was never going to get it.
Oh. It's woodworm of the sea. It's a type of mollusk. It's a kind of clam. It's not actually a worm, really, at all. And it loves to eat wooden ships. And it was partly responsible for the defeat of the Spanish Armada. Here is a picture, and they are amazing. Basically, there are a pair of very small shells at one end with which they can drill the passage, OK? And also, because you open them like this, they can stop the passage that they're drilling falling in on themselves. And the reason this is really important is that the great engineer, Mark Brunel, looked at shipworms and how they were working, and that is how he created the tunnelling device with which he made the very first tunnel under a navigable river under the Thames, and that was the shipworms that enabled that to happen. Do you not think that's amazing? But they infested all four ships on Columbus's fourth voyage. Drake's Golden Hind, Cook's Endeavour, they all had hulls, frankly, like sponges. Because of the shipworms, but they did help defeat the Spanish Armada because they weakened the structure of the larger and more powerful Spanish ships and made them vulnerable to storms and to cannonballs and so on. And they're possibly more responsible for the Spanish defeat than either the weather or indeed the English Navy. Don't you think it's amazing to be an engineer and have a look at how a creature is working and
very
think...
Very clever chap, Brunel.
I know.
What, not like Freud and those eels?
I know, he had no idea.
Nowhere.
No. Could not find a gonad for love nor money.
Brunel with Freud.
Brunel's like,
what are you doing?
Let me deal with this.
You're not thinking this at all, are you? You're learning nothing from every dissection, nothing. Stop, walk away, you have another idea. Look at another creature.
But even today, they cause an estimated £1 billion worth of damage every year. I mean, in modern terms, they can be considered the great recyclers of the sea because they process a resource that most animals cannot eat, wood.
What do they eat if there's no wood, though?
No, that's it. That's their diet.
That's their whole diet.
That's the whole diet. And it was a problem for them when copper bottoms came into shipping, when they discovered that it was possible to kind of copper bottom the whole thing. I mean, the thing that there's an old copper bottoms boat.
That's my username on Tinder. What? Old copper bottom.
Shipworms are also eaten by some people in the Philippines. It's called tamalok. They marinate it with vinegar or lime juice, chopped chili peppers and onions.
I'll stick to that top bit, I reckon.
Do you think?
It's that green stuff.
Yeah, the green stuff.
But even like, even what they marinate with sounds nasty.
Didn't David Attenborough say we all should be or will be eating insects?
Oh, he says a lot of mash.
He'll say anything. Though, I've been eating.
God, he's always just saying something crazy and we all go, oh, what was... No,
are you
not
dissing David Attenborough? That's a bold move.
Hey, listen, I say what I say. If David Attenborough wants some, he knows where to find me.
Jamali's trying to win his audience back after sourdough gate.
Yeah, I know.
Attenborough spends all his time at home now caring for his snakes.
Yeah.
He doesn't want to be disturbed.
No, leave me alone. Now, what happens if you feed Alka-Seltzer to a seagull? Go, Jamali.
They explode.
Oh, what a shame. I hope it was true.
Does that mean it was right?
No. Why do you think...
Because I heard it in a movie.
Yeah, OK.
It's one of the best bits of Independence Day, isn't it?
Yeah, I heard it's something to do with, like, the... with fizzes and the acid in their stomach can't take it and it explodes.
OK, it is not true, thankfully, I'm afraid. The idea is that the birds don't belch and therefore the gas will increase in their stomachs until they can't take it. And the truth is that birds are experts at regurgitation, so they can easily remove anything in the stomach that is causing them discomfort. The stereotypical seagull is a herring gull, and they did very interesting research into them at Exeter University. They found they prefer to eat food that has been handled by humans. They've had two buckets with wrapped flapjacks, and one had been handled for 60 seconds with by a person, and 79% of the girls chose the one that had been handled by human beings.
Maybe they like it a little bit warmed up, you know.
Just no, I think they just want to piss us off. Anybody know how to recognise a black-headed gull?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They haven't got a black head.
It's correct. Yeah, yeah. You get an extra point, Josh.
That's never happened before.
In the summer, they have a dark brown head, and the rest of the year, it's white. They don't have a black-headed gull at all. But you can tell by the colour of the head what season it is. I mean, you can tell as well by the weather, frankly.
The ironic thing is the one on the right looks like a seagull's crapped on its head.
What shape do bees make honeycombs into?
Hexagon.
It was previously thought that bees built their honeycombs out of hexagons. And there's a lot of people thought, how have they done that? Have they made a perfect hexagon?
Well, when you say previously thought, I mean, what you can do is actually look at it.
Yeah.
There it is.
So, what they've actually... what they've actually done...
The famous honeycomb shape.
They create circular-shaped cells using their own bodies as a mould.
Yes.
And then those form a hexagonal shape by themselves, the same way that bubbles sit together in a bubble bath.
What kind of bees make milk? No. That's the important question.
Yeah. The point is, we thought that...
Boobies.
Have you been home educating your kids? How is that going?
This is the tone of voice.
They're not going to get
of homeschooling in the Davis household.
Yeah.
Just do it, and then bring it to me. Try to do it.
Just
you haven't tried to do it. I can't read that.
So, well, the point is, Alan, that we thought that bees knew how to
never
make
mind
hexagons.
The point is, Alan, you know the hexagons, and you've shown some weird bee not actually in a honeycomb. Oh, this is a good picture where it's not a hexagon. Find a proper one. Your own time you're wasting.
Bees are one of the few insects that can survive a winter. How do they do that?
Stay indoors.
Central heating.
Kind of. Oh. Their own central heating, in a way.
Bundled together?
Yes, exactly right, madam. Yeah. Yes, you get an extra point. They stay warm by forming a ball of bees. It's about the size of a basketball, and it's around the queen. In order, it's important to keep her warm. And it's got two layers, so the bees on the outside are packed tightly together and facing inwards. Yeah, and it's like a kind of quilt, so the ones on the inside can move around freely.
Penguins do that too, right?
Yeah.
But they all come together, and then one goes on the outside, and they, you know,
that's exactly
alternate,
right. Yeah, it's the same sort of thing. Now, how can you tell if your dog's happy to see you?
Oh, they're not.
They wag their tails, Andy.
Oh, dear.
And again. The evidence is widespread.
The tail wagging does not necessarily indicate happiness. It's a kind of communication. They are trying to signal submissiveness, for example. Inferior wolves would wag their tails when approaching superior ones. But if it was happiness, when the dog is alone, it would wag its tail if suddenly it saw some food or something, and they don't do that. It is a way of trying to communicate either with another dog or with the person. It's a bit like fidgeting. It can be excitement or it can be nerves.
How do we know? How do we know it doesn't
wag its tail?
I mean, if a dog wags its tail and no one's there to see it, can't we really say it hasn't wagged its tail?
There's this new thing called cameras. How can you make your cat smile at you?
Oh, cats. Don't start with cats. I used to have two, and one would go to the top of the curtains and the other one would rip the curtains down trying to get it. That sums them up. Sums them up.
Molly, have you got cats or dogs?
I had a dog. Well, I only had a dog for like a week once because.
Wasn't it your dog?
Yeah, kind of. So I had this bike, and then a guy said to me, I want to buy the bike. He goes, I'll trade you. And I go, what you got? And he goes, I've got nunchucks. So I got the nunchucks, and I said, you got to chuck in 20 quid. He went, all right, cool. So I went home. My mum's like, where's your bike? I was like, I've only got nunchucks and 20 quid. And she's like, well, no, go back and get your bike. And I went back and I was like, I need my bike back. And he goes, all right, but I'll give you this dog instead. And I went, all right. So I took the dog back. And then someone's knocked at my house because that guy had stole the dog.
Oh, my word.
So I had to then give the dog back. But I got to keep the nunchuck, so it's a happy ending.
Sandy, do you know what a nunchuck is?
What I do know is that Jamali and I have very different lives.
That's a dog I had once.
Wow. OK. How can you make your cat smile at you?
Can they smile?
Can they smile?
Can they smile, Josh?
Well, I've got two cats. They have never smiled.
OK.
They haven't got like, animated
it's
mouths,
something
have
that
they?
Callie said early on about snakes.
You rub both their penises in their ears.
You urinate on it. Yes.
I'm not going to check that. When I get home and I say to my wife, here's a trick for you. Go and get the cat.
Yeah. I thought you were going to say, go and get the camera.
They can make an expression that looks like a smile, but it's actually something called a Flamen response. It means to bare the upper teeth. And it means that they're analysing a smell, so a smell like urine, and drawing the scent particles into the roof of the mouth. Uh-huh. If you weed on a cat, it would look like it was smiling. In fact, the best way to make your cat happy is to slowly blink at it. So,
while you're peeing or just as
no, don't think you need to pee. They're more likely to approach if you have an outstretched hand indicating trust, but if you've been slow blinking at it, then they think that must be OK.
But everyone else in your house is like, we're going to call a doctor.
I'm just going to bring on the cat.
Slow blinking and pissing on the cat.
You could learn many things from your puppy dog's tails. Speaking of which, what are little boys made of?
They were sugar and spice and all.
Girls were
sugar and spice and all things nice.
And boys?
Bad shit.
Bad shit.
That's it.
Cigarette smoke and petrol. I don't know.
Cigarette smoke and petrol.
Slugs and snails and puppy dog's tails.
Oh, yes.
But there have been lots of versions of the rhyme. So from the 1820s, it had snips and snails, snigs and snails, or snakes and snails. A snig is a young eel. And a snip is a sort of morsel of something, and then longer versions with old men made of slippers that flop and a bald-headed top. Women are reels and jeels and old spinning wheels. Mm. The truth is, little boys and little girls are actually made mostly of water, like almost all other living things. I want you to put these pictures in order of which contains the most water.
Cucumber
at number one, we agree on that?
I think
then
yes.
What?
Yeah. What about slug? Number
slug?
Two?
We're going to go for slug number two? Yeah,
I'd say a baby.
For number three?
Yeah.
OK, then?
I've always thought women are more watery than men. I've said it for years.
You can't say those things anymore.
I can't say that anymore. Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Am I going to be cancelled for that, am I?
Is that not a compliment, then? Yeah.
No.
No?
No.
Do you know, Callie, you're looking particularly watery today.
Number four?
I'm going to say banana.
Banana, OK. Number five? Woman.
Woman.
Number six, the man.
Dry old man.
Let's have a look, see if you got it right.
Oh no!
Yeah, so...
You were reverse.
So a woman is made of 55% water and an adult male is 60% water.
Oh.
Losers! Losers! Oh, you're so dehydrated. Would you like a drink?
We've got water to spare, yeah.
I like that a baby falls between a slug and a banana. Can I just show you my favourite slug? The slender banana slug. It's a hermaphrodite, and that means that it can exchange sperm both ways during mating. After sex, one slug will sometimes chew its partner's penis off.
Oh. Mm. But then you'll still live?
Yes, because the idea is that the slug will not be able to mate as a male in the future and therefore will allocate its resources to becoming a mother.
That's not a bad idea. I never... Two kids in and I didn't think of that.
Never.
Go on, then. I enjoyed that. Chew it off. Yeah, let's go out on a high.
Would anybody, if you found a snail in your garden, would you throw it into the neighbour's garden?
Yeah, we had just snail. So many snails last summer. The gardener turned up.
Mm. And the gardener?
It's a middle-class story.
Yeah, but...
Spent all day chatting to the cook, doing no work.
He said he's never seen snails like it. Anyway, I wish I hadn't brought him up. He's literally not even a part of the story.
He is now.
Anyway, I got this organic thing, because I felt bad, but, it said... That I put it down, and it said the snail... don't worry, it's fine. Snails eat it and then they just burrow underground.
Right, and die.
Well, they didn't mention that, but I presume that's what happened.
Yeah. 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 It's like a vegetarian's way of getting rid of animals.
Yeah. Why don't you just put, like, I was going to say salt, but Himalayan pink sea salt.
Yeah, that's... Yeah.
It's more what you... Yeah. I was going to say normal table salt, but I know you... Why don't you go out there with that... that grinder. Josh, don't waste the salt. I have to, darling.
He'd have got the cook to do that. Yeah, that's right. They did a study of throwing snails. 416 snails, they threw them over a wall and then they were marked and then thrown again if they returned, and one snail came back 17 times. And that brings our safari to a slimy close. Let's take a swift look at the scores. In last place, moving at a snail's pace with minus 19, it's Alan. With minus 17, Jamali.
I should say at this point, I've never won.
Me neither.
Okay. In second.
And just to note, my gardener is a huge fan of the show.
This has never happened before, this sort of tension.
In second place, with minus 6, it's Callie. With the lion's share and 3 whole points, it's Josh Widdicombe! Thanks to Callie, Jamali, Josh and Alan. I leave you with this from American columnist Doug Larson. Never doubt the courage of the French. They were the ones who discovered that snails are edible. Good night.